Hi, in my latest video I made fairy paste, a cheap homemade alternative to ferrofluid, but how well do the two compare? In this video I'll do some experiments with them and even set them on fire, just to see how they compare. This time I'll have fun with magnetism and fire. Please don't let fire have fun with you. Also be aware of how messy any type of ferrofluid will be. Let's start by looking at how funny they are to play with. Ferrofluid is amazing to play around with, but you quickly realize that it's very uniform. It forms either a blob or spikes. It may vary between a lot of small spikes or a few larger ones, but always a blob or spiked. Except under the right conditions, where you may see some fawned spikes. Fairy paste is a better shapeshifter. It can form spikes, cell walls, plates, ridges, etc. You can't really predict what it will end up looking like, since this level of variation will make me play with fairy paste for longer periods of time. Fairy paste scores the point for playability, in my opinion. On a more serious note, ferrofluid has some practical uses. For example, as a seal around shafts in hard disk drives or as a coolant in voice coil gaps in loudspeakers. The voice coil is heated by the power from the amplifier passing through it. By applying the right ferrofluid in the voice coil gap, it will help cool the voice coil and even dampen unwanted vibrations, sound, giving the speaker a clear sound. It is mostly used in tweeters, but I'm using a woofer because I want to see if the ferrofluid will stay in the gap even when the bass is bumping. The ferrofluid I have is not for loudspeakers. It will evaporate over time and gum up in the gap, especially when heated by the voice coil. It may even catch fire at full volume during a party. It also has very low viscosity, so it may splatter all over the place. Let's see. No, it is doing well. The magnetic field is strong enough to hold the liquid firmly in place. Even the ripped coil pumping hard in it will not make it splatter. Impressive. Let's try with fairy paste. At first, it looks promising. It reacts like ferrofluid, except for the brown liquid forming. It seems to separate and it no longer looks promising at all. When I assembled the speaker for test again, there was a clear problem. The cone wasn't springy anymore. The separated magnetite was locking the coil in any position I pressed it down to. Nevertheless, I tried playing some music on it. There's still no splatter. However, it clearly wasn't working well. No matter the polarity when hooked up to the amplifier, the coil would always sink down and stay low. I tried taking the cone off and test in free air with a separate magnet, but it only got worse. The fairy paste does not like the heat coming from the voice coil. I tried turning the volume down a bit, but little did it help. Well, that's the weirdest clip you'll see from me for a while.
Oh god, that smells.
Obviously, ferrofluid wins here. It has some unique, practical uses that fairy paste simply can't match. The next test will be how well they can detect tiny magnetic fields. I have shown earlier how Ferrofluid will visualize the magnetic stripe on a credit card. Here's another obsolete credit card. The trick is to get a thin layer. And there you go. Ferrofluid easily shows the two magnetic stripes on this card. Ferri paste, on the other hand, is too thick and granular to show such small details. I tested Ferrofluid on a low capacity hard disk drive too, but didn't see anything. On a VHS tape, it shows the pulse control track at the lower edge of the magnetic tape. I didn't see the analog video and audio tracks. The smallest tracks I saw with Ferrofluid were on a good old floppy disk. They are barely visible with the naked eye, but zoomed in, you can see the circular tracks. Since only Ferrofluid is able to show tiny fields, it's another win for it. The cleanup?
Oh, the cleanup.
They are both horrible in this respect. Ferrofluid can seem impossible to control and contain. It will find and hide its nanoparticles in cracks and creases you didn't even know exist. Ferri paste is like a motor oil-based paint. Imagine playing with that in your living room. Honestly, they both lose a point in this category. Shame on both of them. How about storage? This commercial ferrofluid must be kept in an airtight container since the petroleum will evaporate if left in the open for a prolonged time. But the magnetite and carrier fluid will not separate. The temperature alone is enough to suspend and mix the tiny magnetite particles by Brownian motion. To my knowledge, the ferri paste will not evaporate, but I haven't had it for enough time to be sure. However, the magnetite particles are bigger and will slowly sink to the bottom. You will need to mix ferri paste again after long storage. Since ferrofluid will never separate and always is ready for action out of the bottle, it wins in storage. Just make sure it is in an airtight and spill-proof container. I always wanted to see how ferrofluid burns, so for safety reasons, we'll test how easily they catch fire. At first, I tried directly on top of a sphere magnet. I thought I could get away with using a tiny amount of ferrofluid forming spikes on the top pole. It didn't work as planned, but for a failure, it is quite interesting. Notice what happens when I try to set it on fire. There seems to be some form of convection. I wasn't able to light it on fire, so let's try a different setup. For something flammable, I was expecting a bigger blaze. Have some patience, I will not give up. The ash is mostly magnetite and still useful for detecting a magnetic field. Ferri paste should be even more difficult to ignite based on the flash points. But with higher spikes and without convection, I may be able to ignite it. Oh, okay. It just lights up like a candle. Once again, the magnetite is left behind, this time as some crumbly spikes. Don't use any of these near a candle or your smoking uncle, but ferrofluid seems to be the hardest to ignite in small quantities and wins the point. Last but not least, the price is an easy win for the fairy paste. It is around 30 times as cheap. The bottle of ferrofluid donated by supermagneta.com is worth over 400 euros, while I made 1 kilogram of fairy paste for around 150 Danish kroner, equal to around 20 euros. Fairy paste takes the last point, and it's time for my conclusion. In the 7 categories I have chosen, ferrofluid is a safe winner on points, 3-1. Still, price and playability may matter the most, so fairy paste isn't a total loser. I'll place links in all the usual places to the video about how to make it. Thanks for watching. I hope you liked it enough to click the thumbs up button. And maybe subscribe, because in an upcoming video I will unbox something very special for all you big magnet lovers out there. There's a new monster in my house.